want to make sure that it gives a deterrent effect. Others. Or you use that in your sentencing, it can be a deterrent.
I have never used it in my sentencing thought process.
Why not?
Because I'm more concerned about the person who's standing in front of me. Whether they have a criminal history, facts and circumstances of the case, whether there are mitigating factors, including addiction. I think on a macro level, there's a general deterrent effect when people who commit crimes are prosecuted in jail, but I don't think any one particular sentence is going to make a difference.
I've heard that over the years, but I always say, well, I don't think people are getting the message because our jails are stuffed full. So somehow we're not getting that message out to people and stuff.
Yeah, that's not stopping.
Do you think all interrogations by police should be recorded in audio and video recording?
Yes, that's the best practice.
They just recommend it now for murder cases. But wouldn't that save a lot of hassle for all on video recording?
I agree.
You wouldn't do half or a quarter of the motions to dismiss or suppress the case, right?
I'm not sure. I think a lot of times defense attorneys feel like they have to file a motion to suppress to report.
Yeah, but it's right there, black and white. Pretty hard to make the case that something went wrong. Or on the other side, it's pretty easy to say, look, we kept the guy in the room for 23 hours.
Right. That certainly helps. I agree.
And we have the capability to do that today.
I think more and more police departments are doing that. But it should be. I think it should be done in all cases.
We have a sex registry in this compound.
Yep.
Do you think there are too many crimes included in that registry?
I do. I mean, not from my professional experience, but just hearing about people who wind up on the registry that don't necessarily need to be there. Really sex offenders, but because of the crime they've been charged with, they weren't.
Yeah, like a statutory record. You got a kid who's going out with a girl in high school. She turned 16 and she's 15 and 11 months. They do what they've been doing for the last year. And the mother gets one of those charged to get the statute. I mean, I can't imagine why that. Convicted even juvenile
court.
Judge, unless the judge allows the motion to keep him off, but he will register for at least 10 years. He'll never get a job. He won't get a job in the United States. So, that is what else. So, you were a prosecutor in the federal system.
Was.
Let me ask you this, see if you agree with it. The function of the prosecutor under the federal constitution is not to tack as many skins and victims as possible against the law. His function is to vindicate the rights of the people as expressed in the laws and give those accused of the crime a fair trial. Do you agree with that?
I do.
You know who said it?
No, I don't.
William O. Douglas. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor. Counselor Dubs?
Thank you. Nice to see you, Judge.
Good afternoon.
Do you need a break?
I'm okay for it.
Thank you for all the time you afforded me. You spoke about a couple of things I want to go back and touch on. And one of them is particularly important to me, and that's jury instructions.
Yes.
My colleagues have heard me speak about this before. I have a constituent whose father was killed in a brutal crime. And the murderer was actually let off on what he believes is the testimony for the jury instructions. So can you just share with me, did you write about these? Have you thought about these? Or you touched on it earlier.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly.
that I said, we'll be able to look back and see what the instructions said. Before they're compiled, I talk to both sides, you know, and make sure that whatever they like to see in there, I'll consider incorporating what they want. A lot of times, when you get to the end of the trial, parties are sort of like, oh, we're done, if they don't think it's hard, like the jury instructions, which are very important. And so that's why, knowing that some people hear things and learn that way, and some people can learn it and understand it better if they read it, I know to do it.
Judge Lowy does that too. He gives them the instructions. And I think it's great. I mean, you know, when you hear these stories, when you hear it from a constituent, it's particularly poignant. And then I read the case, and it's, you know, well, it was just perfect. So it's something I've always promised when I will ask. Also, your views on the U.S. Constitution, do you consider it a living, breathing document? And you've touched on this before, but I am going to ask, because I get asked all the time, and the reason I ask, I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to ask you about equal marriage and about a woman's right to choose. And the reason why I drill down so much and want absolute answers from not just you, but anyone that's sitting there as a judicial nominee, is the importance of our state courts. They're more important than ever. Because we're seeing across the country this domino effect of rights, civil rights, women's rights, gay, lesbian rights, just being eroded. And it doesn't seem, even though we have rulings from the Supreme Court, there's this constant, you know, thing going on. And so for women and men in Massachusetts who are concerned about the woman's right to choose, we need to be quite confident that folks would put in a position where you could possibly have to make a ruling on it, feel the way and reflect what the constituents of the Commonwealth do. So can you expound a little bit more on that?
So a woman's right to choose is well established here in the Commonwealth. It goes back to 1981. There's no question but that here, I can't ever imagine there being something, some sort of legislation attempting to restrict women's right to choose. I think here in Commonwealth, it's very well established.
So you can tell us that absolutely if a challenge cannot ever progress to the Supreme Judicial Court, that you would uphold women's right.
Well established, how we follow the Constitution, and it allows for women's right to choose. I can't see that changing.
My concern is, and I'm not going to be bad at this, my concern is the fact that we are still talking about it 43 years later means that it's not well established. Unfortunately. And, you know, as you and I discussed, I don't think choice is easy. But who am I to make that? I'm not, and I'm not going to, and I don't want to, but it is my responsibility for the next generation, for our generation, for the next generation, to really make sure that their rights are well protected, because we do have some pretty archaic laws on in the books in Massachusetts that, you know, you never think they're going to be brought into effect, but then you never know. So I thank you for clarifying that a little bit more. I find in Council Case nice to talk about this, you know, when I came on that listening is where learning and understanding really happens. And I found you to be an excellent listener when I spoke to you. I find you to have a few things that are intangible qualities that no one else before us, albeit they were fine nominees, have. And what is your life experience as an African American woman? I don't think that can be underestimated. I don't think, you know, you and I talked a little bit about growing up in Peabody, those years where I grew up, you know, what that was like. Because it had to be different. You know, your growing up and my growing up had to be just completely different. So I appreciate that. And I can't emphasize how important it is to have on this board. The thing that you have, Judge Budd, that I'm going to be honest, it's has been revealed to me even more today, I don't want to say unexpected, but it wasn't something that I always see, is the intangible quality that I'm looking for in every single justice, that, or potential justice, that's before us. And that's the humanity and the compassion that will allow them to continue their growth as a person and a jurist. And I have to say, I don't want to say pleasantly surprised, because there's part of me that's not surprised at all. But it, to me, it's been revealed over the course of the day. And it makes me feel awful confident in your appointment to this court. It's not something we always see, and it's not something you can quantify. It's the very essence of being somebody. And I congratulate you on that, in your family, in your husbands and sons, and family. You must be a very special group of people. And don't take it for granted. It's hard growing up in a family with all men, especially when you grow up in a family with all sisters. That's right. I know, because I had almost the same coming up, albeit different as it was. So I really don't have any more questions for you. We spoke many times, but last week we spoke extremely, and we spoke, and then you listened to my speeches, and exchanged ideas and my views of the world, and you know, what I think and what I'm looking for and what I'm hoping for. And I think you really embody it. And I just want to say again, in some ways that I really almost didn't expect this, but absolutely today when I experienced you here in this question. So, you know, thank you. And done.
Thanks so much. How's my pen?
Cool intuition. You need that. And a part of it is professional. All the things you did, including that mark here. I've been in front of you many times over the years. Probably I've ever done a trial, but I've been in front of you many times. And I can assure the council members that what they see is what they get. Because I've seen how you've acted on the bench, I've seen how you've dealt with people, and dealt with litigants, and it's the same thing. So what you see is what you get. I have a long history with your father and your godfather, going back decades upon decades upon decades. And your father taught me the agency and corporations class in law school. Do you think you can get him to revisit that final exam? Maybe just a little bit better. Get my GPA again. And of course, the general, I met him when I was first out of law school in started working in Middlesex. I met when he was especially assigned to a case down in Norfolk County as a special prosecutor in the Middlesex County. He was the first assistant, where I shared an office in the Maryland District Court with Ralph Martin, who's here. And Ralph had called me about it, that's why I got it up, as soon as your name answered spoke. I also got an email from Judge Regina. Great. I only got a couple of questions because we've spent a lot of time together. We've spoken quite a bit over the last month and a half or so. Court administration. You're going to be replacing the court administrator, Gary Spence, leaving Sharp. And I think that when you get out there and just get out of the gate, that's probably the most important thing that you're going to be doing in terms of the impact it's going to have on the day to day operations of the courts. What kind of administrator are you going to?
Well, we might talk about this, and I do think it's important to have somebody who has a familiarity with the court system.
The current court administrator did not weaken, and all due respect, I don't think that is And ultimately, it's their responsibility in terms of how the courts run. They didn't really seem to know, they kind of knew what was going on, but didn't really seem to know how it was about, and didn't seem to have any input in it at all. It seemed to be a decision that was made by the court administrator in conjunction with Judge Carey. Are you going to relook at that when you get up there?
Well, my biggest concern that I have is the actual people who are being displaced.
Yeah, me too.
So I want to make sure that they are okay. That's what I would look for. That would be.
They're not being taken care of. They're being thrown out. Period. Not being given anything. They're being given thank you very much. Show them the book. It's not right. There was a bill in the legislature that we give them an early retirement of 5 years, like the age of 5 years of their time, and that didn't make the legislative session. So if they've been given nothing, they're just done. The last thing I'm just going to mention is that people are missing something very historic. There isn't going to be one African American woman on the Supreme Judicial Court. A little while, there's going to be two. And I think that's pretty significant. I think diversity is very, very important. I think it is a factor that we absolutely should look at and consider when we are making this decision. If we were to have one nominee after another nominee after another nominee that looked like me, a little short, balding Irish guy, I wouldn't be too happy about it. It's Irish. So I'm very pleased at that as well. I think it's something to look at and consider. But whether you're an African American woman, are a little Irish guy like me, you're clearly qualified. There's no question about that. I made no secret of my support for you, and I'll be voting for you next week.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Casey? Thank you. My colleague, my left, very appropriately, my left, go next.
Some
Shane, how is it that he writes under the Declaration of Rights, our Constitution?
No, I just think that we all have certain views and civil rights that are important to us. We all should stick together for protection of our civil rights and civil liberty. Because one day they might come for civil liberty or civil rights that's important to you. We all need to have vision and respect for our Bill of Rights.
Can I go on record saying that you're all important to me?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you. Area, and I think we touched on it when we met the standing orders. You know, the standing orders that are drafted by committees and put together, and committees are usually selected by who's ever in charge of a certain department, who's ever the head person, whether it's a probate court department. They put together committees and they work on these standing orders, and then it's my understanding that the SJC has to ultimately approve them. And what's happening, or what the trend has been, is that some of these standing orders look a lot like legislation. And you know, I've asked the two previous SJC nominees about this because it's concerning as a practitioner that there's very little notice of these committee hearings where they're drafting these rules. It's very secret. There's no election process per se of who's on the committee, and judges are appointed. So you have these standing orders, and I'll give you an example. Recently, out of the Family and Probate Court, standing order 2-16, which deals with the parent education program. Now, this was just recently enacted by the SJC, and what it does is it basically creates further costs, requires additional filings by counsel. And it was all done without any legislative approval or democratic vetting, if you will, the legislative process. Now we have this rule in place that's not really publicized for public hearing and comment. Didn't go through the legislature, but now it's a standing order that everybody has to comply with. There's not really even any scientific proof that parent education classes. I just raised the issue. I'm not looking for any specifics, obviously. You know, there are a ton of standing orders that'll be, but just as a general principle, if you are confirmed, I really like to see the SJC give a little bit more scrutiny in some of these standing orders because they cripple practitioners, they're not practical, again, the administrative, court administrator issue, and not for people who are practicing in the courts. They don't do I wish that the SJC would start scrutinizing a little bit more because it seems like whatever's putting in front of the SJC, they're putting the standing orders. Can you speak to that?
Well, I think that standing orders generally are supposed to be about the orderly running of a courtroom. If they go beyond that, I don't know the specifics of the probation. Maybe something that could end up, you know, being challenged because, you know, as far as I'm concerned, it's supposed to be about the
procedure, and that's fine. Yeah. So I raised that. I mean, you're going to be, you know, going to be a lot of these issues coming up. What administrator was going to ask about that? I'd like to answer that. Should be local, something within the system. I think I have heard that the parent information line search, and I just kind of chuckled. You were asked about your position on pro-choice and pro-life, and did you make a woman's right to choose? What about partial birth abortion? Do you think, I mean, at what point, assuming the mother's life is not at risk,
right.
issues about it. I don't feel equipped to answer that question as we sit here today. No. It's a very difficult issue. It's a difficult choice for to make. It's not something that I appreciate your answer, Mike. I agree. I made a crack a few weeks ago. Like, why is it that my hair feels always want to ask for more about abortion? You know, it's an interesting issue looking at it that way, but you know, I don't think that there's a difference between saying a woman has a right to choose and being charity for abortion. So, I don't think that we always distinguish carefully between those two. As a player, I agree with you that women has a right to choose. I don't think it's healthy. I know that there's some pretty animated positions with respect to that issue. Walking around with signs and screaming that it's, you know, the Red Sox. You know, it's usually the lowest point in a woman's life, emotionally, psychologically, and so, you know, it's a very difficult issue. I agree with you. Very private. I think it is different than the just general discussion about the right to choose about the situation where mother's life is not at risk. But I can understand your position on that issue. Just on the preparation for the hearing today. Spent a little time on that. I just want to say that, you know, if the nominee comes in, you know, whether it's a district court, a position on the parole board, a position on the Massachusetts tax appellate board, a position on superior court, probate court, housing court, land court, whatever you name your court, you name your board, they don't take the time, care, listen to the hearings that this council has conducted, watch it online. Provides an invaluable service to folks on that. You know, they're really not prepared in the way that they're showing respect that the process demands. So the fact that you listen to hearings, you met with us, you put yourself through a mock hearing, if you will, I think that that's fantastic. I hope that any nominee can prepare themselves that way for this, especially for the SJC. Lose anything by that. We're not all bound by the questions we've asked in previous hearings, and as you can tell, some of the questions are, you know, they're not on script. Those things come up, and we try to, as my colleague said, drill down on some of this stuff when the questions come up. So I just want to say that I, you know, where I come from, we call that preparation, and I think it's evident that you're prepared for this hearing. And I didn't ask you this question, so what do you want your legacy to be? Because you'll have a legacy if you sit on and then be in what have you. I mean, you're going to leave a mark on the state, mark on people in this Commonwealth for a very long time.
Thanks. I would like my legacy to be, you know, I don't know, I know that so many different things have come before the board. Over the course of the time that I'll be there, you receive this coming. I just want to be known as somebody who achieves opportunity and things that move on.
According to Judge Tim Hillman, you are I just want to highlight, you know, me guess. You drink. You drink for seconds. You are a very interesting woman. That's a great background. Very diverse. I mean, you get the business, you get the private sector, you get the instructional capacity, you get the public safety component as an ADA. I mean, really, it's really the whole picture. So, I think you're an outstanding selection. And I just want to also say that it sounds to me like you come from a family of trailblazers. And you know, I know that everybody knows your dad. You know, you're certainly going to be a historical role. I didn't know this, but in preparing for today, I didn't realize that your father was the youngest, age 38. So on that note, thank you for your time, thank you for being, and thank you for your reference.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Kennedy, then Councilor Hammond.
You have a shot of standing up for your needs. We kept everybody else for 6:30. We tell all you guys down, we kept you at 6:30. We don't want the mess.
Good afternoon, Judge. I don't have any questions or comments. When Governor Baker sent the nomination in on June 25th, in less than 24 hours to go public, he announced my support for the nomination. And at the time, I said in my public release that the Budd family is one of the great public service families in America. And I had a chance to work with your grandfather, Joe Budd. But a friend of mine, outstanding man, and he spoke, he was the first African-American police officer in the city of Springfield. He was true. He made it to captain. Except for the color of his skin, he would have been the chief of police in Springfield, Massachusetts. No question about it. And one of the highlights of my public service career as mayor is having the opportunity to name Joseph Budd Human Assessment Center. And he was a great man. Your aunt, Andy, principal at Central High School, every kid in that school and their families, 2,000 kids. And one of the great disappointments of my life, my public service life, was I couldn't make her the superintendent of schools in Springfield. And I tried. But she would have been great. And she did make it to the deputy superintendent status, and she was an outstanding educator. Your father probably doesn't remember this, but he offered counsel to me on civil rights matters when I was mayor. Always accepted my phone call. He's more than ready to offer advice in a city like Springfield, where there is tension, racial tension, tension between the police and communities of color, and the difference to me and his advice is always on target, well received. So, you have an outstanding background, there's no question about it. And my good friend to my right says she knows how to count. And one of the proudest moments of my public service career, we hope to confirm you, the Springfield Board of Massachusetts next week. So I wish you the very, very best. You're going to have a great legacy. Everyone's talking about age. I don't think you're too old. Be on the Supreme Judicial Court. I wish you were a little bit younger. And perhaps the greatest surprise about this, I didn't realize that Tom Riley was your father. Which made me track the Budd family. But just to say, you've got two kids here from Theodore High School, Wayne Budd and Tom Riley, all these years, friends. You know, it says an awful lot. It really does, coming from the background that they came from. I really do wish you the very best. You could be outstanding. I could be more proud. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor. Would any of the counselors like to be heard again? Thank you. lot of time, effort, meeting with you, speaking with others, reading letters, support for you, and doing your homework and coming here today. That's been an honor and a pleasure to be in this room today, especially giving your family a service to our Commonwealth. And I think the most profound part of today is your sons. Listen to the questions, listen to your life story of success, special woman in our Commonwealth, balancing the joys of being a woman. Thank you for allowing us to place your name in nomination. We look forward to next Wednesday when this council will take up the vote. And thank you all very much for being here today. This concludes our journey.
Thank you for telling me. I guess I just never looked. I saw you taking it.
I'm very good with the internet.
Are you?
Yes.
I don't.
Never forget, Google owns YouTube.
Right, right.
And if you put it in one, it'll show up in the other.
Right, that's awesome. I don't know. I'm working so many hours, I don't tend to go on with too many. So
I know, they run you ragged. I've seen it.
How are you doing today?
Good work. This guy, I'll see you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Wednesday.